I'll start and then my husband will take over. Thank you, Denise, for that song we shared last night about when I got saved. That was the song that got burned in my heart. I have decided to follow Jesus. And I took that to heart, and it was like crossing the Rubicon, and there was no turning back. And every time that the going got tough, the Spirit would remind me of that song, and I just keep on keeping on, and I'm never backslidden. Thank you, Jesus. Who would want to go back to where we came from anyway? All right, I just want to give a little short exhortation tonight. I love your theme, Force of Favor. I love that. That's awesome. I just love that because, you know, we're anointed to proclaim the favorable favor or acceptable year of the Lord. And that's what Jesus tells us in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 4, verse 19. But, you know, he talks about us being anointed. So we're anointed to do that. We have favor, and it's the favorable year. And like Brother Russ said about the church is in dire straits, and North America is in dire straits, and they need the gospel. They need the cross. They need Jesus. So in all of that, because of the favor of the Lord, God's bottom line is the harvest. That's his bottom line. If you do anything else, always remember Jesus died on a cross. He rose from the dead, and he's got power in for us in our lives, and we're anointed, and we have his favor to keep on keeping on. We've got the favor of the Lord, and, you know, I often, whenever I speak somewhere, I say, I'm God's pet. Now, a lot of folks don't understand that. I was a teacher, so, you know, you hear the expression, a teacher's pet. Well, you know, I'm God's pet. I'm God's favorite. But, you know, we can all say that. We can't. God's big. He can have lots of favorites, and we're all his favorite. And yet, in Galatians 2:6, we see a scripture that says, God shows no partiality or no personal favoritism. Well, he does, in a sense. It's not that he just hand picks this one and that one, but he wants all of us to be his favorites. Now, let me give you a definition of favor. It means over-generous, preferential treatment, a force in the earth, force of favor. I like the Canadian spelling too. Oh yeah. So I want you to get a vision tonight that we've got to be favor minded. You know, and favor minded is always attached to the harvest, and the harvest is attached to the cross. And I shared yesterday morning at his glory house that how God staked his claim on the earth by putting a sword in the earth. Think about the sword, the handle, it looks like a cross. And that's why the cross is so important. Now, listen to some of the Proverbs about favor. Let not mercy and truth forsake you. Bind them around your neck, write them on the tablet of your heart, and so find favor and high esteem. That means good success in the sight of God and man. In other words, the right people. And you know, we walk in God's favor. I mean, God puts us with the right people. He put us with Eagle Worldwide Ministries. Hallelujah. He put Pastor Maeve and Dr. Russ in our lives. And, you know, they've been such a blessing. And all of you, we love you. You're our family. I mean, we've missed you. We haven't been here since January, and we've missed you. We have missed you. So we're so glad to be back. Yeah. Proverbs 3:34, God gives grace, favor to the humble. And in 8:35, whoever finds me, God says, finds life and obtains favor from the Lord. You know, it starts with God. The moment God is first in our lives, we have favor. We walk in divine favor. He orders our steps. He blesses us left and right. In fact, the blessings overtake us, and they're already at the destination that he's leading us to. I mean, we've seen that. God is so good. He is awesome. And then 11:27, the one who diligently seeks good seeks favor. Hey, it's God's way or the highway. I mean, that's the bottom line. It's God's way or the highway. We do it God's way, we have favor. A good man obtains favor from the Lord. And Proverbs 13:15, it says, good sense wins favor. You know, some folks think being a Christian, you have to lose your mind. No, you get the mind of Christ and you get the wisdom of God. You get smarter. And if you're smarter, you will have favor. Because even in the world, they look for smart people. Did you know that? They don't look for dummies to work. They want smart people. And if we've got God and walking with God and He's first and foremost in our lives, we will have favor. Romans 2:11, God shows no partiality. He loves all of us. He wants all of us to come. He laid His claim to the earth because He wants all of us with Him. I love what Luke 2:40 says in 2:52, talking about Jesus. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. And then the rest of that, Jesus increased in wisdom, stature, and in favor with God and men. So it's not just favor with God, it's favor with God and man always. And let me give you some examples of favor. I mean, just in the natural. Upgrades when you fly. That's nice to have, isn't it? We get upgrades. We get upgrades in the cars we rent. I mean, that's awesome. I mean, really, I go to the grocery store and there are a gazillion cars in the parking lot. I say, oh, God, I need a place close by. My ankle hurts. And then somebody pulls up and I can park in front. Now, the world people, the people think that's crazy, but, you know, it's the truth. We walk in divine favor. I went shopping at Target. I hate that Target went bust in Canada. Man, that's the best store. I mean, really. Come on. I mean, I don't know what happened. But anyway, I was shopping at Target, and I bought a whole bunch of stuff. And the little cash register guy, you know, I looked at him. I said, you know what? You didn't charge me enough. I mean, I know my bill is more than that. He said, oh, I can't be bothered. Just take it. Go on. I said, okay, praise the Lord. I got home, and, I mean, I spent $60, and I had $150 worth of stuff. I mean, you know. No, that was in the U.S. Yeah, I know. They probably were doing that. Yeah. And we walk into restaurants and they just give us stuff. Well, try this. We're just sampling this. Would you like this? Would you like to eat this? Oh, look at these pretty glasses. We're just giving them away. I mean, God is good. I mean, little things, but think about His favor when you go for an interview with a job or anything, you know, or even the bank might make a mistake and in your favor. God's done that with us too. I mean, it's like we tell them, we want to correct them, but they say, forget it, you know, our computers are right. Yeah, right. You know what I mean. You know what I mean. So make sure God is absolutely first in your life all the time. Whatever you do. Whatever you eat, whatever you drink, whatever sport you go to, whatever you, however you act, whatever you talk, whatever you think, it should always give glory to the Lord God Almighty. Let me give you an acronym and then I'm done because my husband's preaching tonight. Favor, F-A, I've got the American spelling, F-A-V-O-R, okay? F is for first. We're first fruits. Romans 8:23, we're the first fruits. Jesus died on the cross for us. We're these first fruits. He laid claim to us. We belong to Him. A is for abundance. When you follow Jesus, we live the life abundant. The devil tries to steal, kill, and destroy, but you know what? He can't win, and you can say, na, 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 na. Jesus won in my life. I mean, we have abundant life. V is for victorious. We walk in victory. We're not victims. Get over that mindset. That's the half full glass. You look at the full glass instead, you know. Our faith is the victory. We've got faith. We can believe God for healing. That's favor. Healing. Financial difficulties. That's favor. Doing things God's way. It works. O is for overcomer. We can overcome in any area. I've got to use you. We get understanding from God. Amen? That's wisdom. We got the wisdom of God and we can walk in understanding. God gave us a brain and He wants us to use it. He really does. R is for reconciled. 2 Corinthians 5:19. God was in Christ reconciling the world to Himself. And because He's reconciled us, we are to reconcile the people all around us. Because it's like a cross. If our relationship is right with God, then we've got this relationship with our brothers or with whomever, wherever, work, pleasure, fun, whatever. First and foremost, what's on God's brain? The harvest. Get that in your minds. It's the harvest. It's all about the harvest. So we do walk in divine favor. Amen? Force. It's a force in the earth. Amen? All right. Here's my husband.
Praise the Lord. Well, there is some transformation going on in the church. I just wanted you to know that. When I met Valerie, she was this little girl in New Brunswick, quiet, just always listening to me, had very little to say. It was amazing. I thought, this could be the woman for me right here. And, you know, when you're a talker, you need a listener, right? And so God gave me a listener, and I praise the Lord for that. And shy, you know, I was always the one who had to approach other people. You can't tell that now, can you? I mean, the transformation is just about complete after all these years. Little Catholic girl, and, you know, we got married, and then the Lord comes into our lives in a powerful way, and transformation was on. But you know, Brother Russ, I agree with you wholeheartedly. I think many of us had expectations that by this time, some things were going to be very different. I think we thought the church would be further along. I think we thought we would all be further down that road of ultimate destiny, praise God, seeing the transformation that we were hearing so much about. But a funny thing happened, and it appears that right now what the church needs, and you prophesied it, we need revival. You know, all day I kept being confronted by one word, blowout. Blowout. Every time I turned around, I'd see the word blowout. It'd be on a sign or somewhere at the mall or what, blowout, you know, this and that. That's what we really need in the church today. We need a blowout. There's not time for tweaking. There's not time for some little minor repairs or whatever else. We need a blowout. We need a major revival and transformation among us. You know, Valerie and I walked into the kingdom via the charismatic renewal. And it was just an incredible time. And that's why I love your music so much, Denise. Yeah, you too, yeah. And your music reminds me of those songs. We were talking the other day about the first time that we were in a charismatic service. We'd gone to this meeting in the basement of the Catholic diocese in Memphis. And they gathered around, and for the first time, we were singing songs with a guitar. We'd never done that in church. We always sang with a piano and an organ. It was very formal and, you know, hymns and all that and, you know, whatever. But, you know, now we were singing songs like we liked, because we were sort of the folk music generation, okay? Peter, Paul, and Mary and all that, you know, and they were kind of our trinity. But anyway, so, you know, all that just brings so much flooding back. That was a tremendous move of God. I believe we need something on an even greater scale than that. We need a blowout, praise God. Something that's just going to blow out the walls, blow down the resistance, blow out all the compromise, blow out all the sin that's in the church. Really? Blow it out, praise God. We need a good house cleaning to the glory of God. We need the favor of God, and we're thankful for the favor of God. We've experienced so much of it in our lives, and we just praise God for everything He's done and is continuing to do for us. But I want to talk tonight about something that I believe is very, very important. If we're going to know the force of favor in our lives, in our walk, in our relationships, in our ministry, we've got to be hooked up with the right people. We've got to be yoked with people who know the favor of God, who are living in the favor of God. They're the kind of people that we should desire to be around. In Revelation chapter 4, a fascinating thing of John being caught up into the presence of the Lord, an open door in heaven, and he's seeing all this incredible visions in the presence of the Lord in the very throne room of God. And there's so much there. He was caught up in the presence of God, the one who sat on the throne, and the scripture says he saw four living creatures. Remember this passage? Four living creatures with the face of a lion, just like that picture over there, the face of an ox, a face like a man, and a fourth that was like a flying eagle. I think that's significant too. Not just one sitting on a perch somewhere, okay? But a flying eagle. There's a very similar passage in the book of Ezekiel, chapter number 1, where again, Ezekiel talks about, he says, the heavens were opened, and I saw visions of God. He said there were four living creatures, just like John was talking about. Four living creatures who had the likeness of a man, but each one had four faces. He said one of them had the face of a man. Each had the face of a man. Each had the face of a lion and on the right side. And each had the face of an ox on the left side. And each had the face of an eagle. Praise God. You know, I've noticed that in the songs that we sing and the pictures that we paint and so many other images and examples that we use, we see a lot with the lion. We see a great deal with the eagle, certainly in this ministry. We certainly know who the Son of Man is, do we not? But the poor old ox, what happened to him? I mean, Mark, it's kind of like they barbecued him or something. You know, what happened to the ox? What does the ox speak to us about the presence of God and what I believe is going to take the church into a new age of revival and transformation? So I just want to start tonight as an ambassador for Eagle Worldwide, okay? I want to start tonight praising God for the man of God, who is the face of this ministry. Now, I'm not shortchanging who the Lord of this ministry is. I'm just saying that every ministry has a face. I mean, you know, if you ever, back in the day, if you talked about ORU, whose face came to mind? It was Oral Roberts, wasn't it? Or, you know, you think about the face of a Benny Hinn or whomever. But when you mention Eagle Worldwide Ministries, my face probably doesn't come to mind. His does. His does. The face, okay? The face of a ministry is so very important, praise God. I mean, how are you going to talk about this ministry without talking about Dr. Russ Moyer? You know, when God sent Samuel to anoint the king who would replace Saul over Israel, and the reason Saul needed to be replaced was Saul's heart was not right. His heart had failed the Lord. Now, he had the appearance of a king. The Bible says he was tall. You know, tall guys always get the advantage. He was a good-looking guy. He was a standout, you know. We were having lunch today, and this guy comes up to wait on our table and with our friends Mervin and Muriel Medwick, and he walked away, and I looked at everybody and I said, I feel like we've been waited on by a movie star. I mean, the guy looked like he stepped right out of one of those modeling ads or something. I thought, wow. But, you know, that's not what God's looking at. That's not what God's looking for. God's looking for the heart. That's what he's interested in. And when Saul failed that heart test, God was looking for a man after his heart. And you know who that was, right? That was David. So God sent Samuel to anoint David as the next king. But remember what he told him? He said, I want you to go to Jesse, the household of Jesse. I want you to look at all of his sons, but don't judge on the basis of their appearance. Or who's the oldest, or who's the smartest, or who's the tallest, or who's done the most exploits, or whatever. I want you to look for the man who has a heart after me. This is the kind of man that God chooses to anoint, to lead, and to rule. This week, weekend, I've been sharing a story about a dear brother from the Charismatic Renewal back in the 60s, Pastor Bob Birch. I don't know if some of you have heard me preach on this, but Pastor Bob Birch was an Episcopal priest in Vancouver, British Columbia. And he pastored a church called St. Margaret's Reformed Episcopal Church. Now, you know, I'm not a great authority on that part of the church, but for me, none of those words go together. You know, I'm like Reformed what? You know, St. Margaret? Who's St. Margaret? You know, what is all this about? St. Margaret's Reformed Episcopal Church. By Pastor Bob's own admission, he said it was a little struggling church. It was strife-ridden. The people couldn't get along. They didn't understand that we've been given the ministry of reconciliation. You know, they thought the church was about being comfortable rather than being made decidedly uncomfortable by the gospel of Jesus Christ. You know, they thought it was everybody should like them and promote them, you know, rather than we should serve one another, you know, and humble ourselves under the... They had it all backwards. The church was poor. They weren't doing well, and I think Brother Bob had just about had all he could take, so he took to the streets. He still kept the church. He was still pastoring, but all during the week, he would walk the streets of Vancouver, British Columbia. On some days, he was carrying a cross on his shoulders that he dragged down the street with him. I bet that caught a sight. You know, in Vancouver, they think they're so cool, you know, and to see this guy coming down the street with a cross, I'm sure that was a howl. And so he's doing this day after day after day. And then one day, these two girls come to him. They were hippies. Remember back, any of you remember the 60s? You know, the 60s feel a lot like today and stuff that's going on. But they were hippies. I mean, they were wild looking. You know, the long hair, the tie-dyed, you know, the whole nine yards and everything. And they come to him and they said, "The Lord sent us to you. We're from California. And the Lord told us to come to you and ask you if you'd receive us in your church, so that we could base our ministry out of your church. We want to reach out to the lost people at Simon Fraser University." Pastor Bob's looking at these two girls. And in his mind, he's kind of, you know how we do? We sort of go through a checklist, you know. And he said, it kept coming up. No, no, no. I have enough trouble with this church. All I need is two hippies coming in here, you know. That'll just about do it. Now we'll have a blowout for sure, okay? But when he opened his mouth, he heard himself say, "Sure, come on over." And so they did. And he said for weeks after that, he was mystified how he could be thinking no. But when he opened his mouth, he said yes. You know what I think it was? Pastor Bob was a man after God's heart. And his heart overrode his head, praise the Lord. And that's where we need to be as the people of God. We need a blowout. We need a turnaround. We need to get things back into a divine priority, where rather than trying to reason and think our way through everything, I'm not against having a good mind, an educated mind, and all of that. I'm just saying that shouldn't be the priority. It ought to be, what's the heart of God? Now, what's the heart of God? A few weeks went by, and Brother Bob wrote that quite a few hippies started coming to the church. Some of them, he said, wow, they were wild. He said they were not housebroken. He said they come to the church, they want to sit in pews, so they just sit in the floor. Or they go sit in the window. Or they just walk up and sit in the choir. He said, I'd look around and I'd be startled. There's this long-haired, bearded guy sitting up there drinking something. He said, God only knew what he was drinking, you know. And he said it was the wildest thing I'd ever seen. And people in the church were really getting angry with me. And a few more weeks went by and the dozens started turning into hundreds. He said There wasn't any room for the old church in there anymore. I mean, it was becoming hippie heaven over here. He said, we didn't know what was going on. See, they were Jesus. Remember Jesus people? Or we used to call them Jesus freaks, okay? But this was what was happening. And as months went by, literally thousands of these people, a generation of rebellion, I guess you could say. A generation that had checked out, were stoned, and whatever else they were on. And yet, they were looking for something. And these two girls understood that. And they were witnesses on that campus of Simon Fraser University. Thousand. Do you know that's where the Jesus People movement began in Canada? In, of all places, St. Margaret's Reformed Episcopal Church. I mean, go figure. Why? Because the man of God, the son of man in that house, had a heart after God. This man's got a heart for a generation and for a nation, praise God. We need to be yoked with the right people, with people that can see beyond their little deal, beyond their fence, beyond their city, beyond even this nation, praise God, to the ends of the earth. I think it's just so vital and so important. Where you find a people with a heart after God, who aren't just running from here to there because, well, they offended me over here and I was challenged over there and they got under my skin. They were supposed to. That's the whole point. That's that whole deal about die to yourself, deny yourself, take up your cross. What do you think the cross is for? To hang lights on? Come on. What is the cross for? It's to die. Paul said, I die daily. Okay? It's to kill off the old man so that something new can come forth to the glory of God. You know, you never outgrow the cross. The cross is never to be behind us. Well, been there, done that. No. Remember that little song we were singing? The cross is supposed to be before us, not behind us, praise God. We need hearts that are open to the knowledge of the truth. So, I see the face of the Son of Man in this ministry. I also want to praise the Lord for the face of the Lion of Judah that we so see so powerfully all through this ministry. That was just beautiful tonight with all that praise and worship. I just love that. You prophesied to me when I walked in that tonight fire was going to fall. We were going to know the presence of God. That's what this ministry is really about. Sunday morning, we were at Aurora at the gathering place. And, oh, what a glorious time. And what I love about that particular church, which is an Eagle Worldwide church, is that there's so much freedom to worship God there. It's just, but that's true in all the churches here, the Eagle Worldwide churches. But, you know, it's so manifest there. And actually, we were kind of talking about that Sunday morning. That's what John and Victoria, they were sharing their hearts. That's what we wanted to do. We wanted to give people the freedom to worship Jesus, praise the Lord. The freedom to lift their hands. The freedom to do something a little out of the ordinary, praise God. You know, the two of you, I've watched the two of you for years now. And when I was watching you tonight, you know what? I saw the cherubim on top of the ark and the wings and just the way that you worship. You are such an integral part of what gives us freedom in this house. We all need somebody that'll forerun, get out there ahead of us, do stuff we wouldn't dream of doing. I mean, do any of you remember the days when our idea of raising our hands to the Lord was kind of half-masked, you know, a little bit, and then you kind of got up to here, sort of, you know, and then one day you just thought, oh, forget it. Let's just get free and love God. Oh, yeah. You know, I remember a day when that would almost get you stoned in church. Really? I mean, you know, people were just oh, you're showing off. You're making a spectacle of yourself. No, I'm just breaking loose. We need a blowout, praise God. We need to be free. It's great to have somebody that's free, really free, but we should all always strive to be freer than we were the night before, praise God. It's just like Val and I. We're so big on this concept of marriage that the goal of marriage is to be one. If you think marriage is anything other than two deaths, you better rethink it, okay? It's two deaths and one resurrection. God's bringing forth something new. That was the will of God from the man and they shall become what? One, praise the Lord. That's what it's about. We confess that every morning. We don't keep the goal before us, folks. In all of these things, our intimacy with the Lord, cultivating the presence of God in our very home, praise God, as well as at the church or out here on the campground. But it's just so very important that we loose the lion to roar to the glory of God. That's what John and Victoria have done up there in Aurora. They've created a place, an atmosphere where God's people can freely worship in spirit and in truth. Listen, without the spirit, all we get is just a form of worship. That was the kind of church I grew up in. I knew the form. You know, I'd been away from church for years. You know, Val was Catholic. I was Protestant. We thought, okay, we just won't go there. You know, we can't reconcile that. But then we got in trouble and we realized we need the Lord. And so we started attending my parents' church, a United Methodist church there in Memphis. And Valerie was so surprised. She said, I never knew you were so religious, because I knew the form. I knew the order. I knew when to stand up. I knew when to sit down. I knew how to go up to the altar and kneel down. And when you got up, which direction you were to turn. Because if you turned the wrong way, we'd all snicker, you know, like, rookie, you know. They don't know how it's done. And, you know, this silly form, but there was no power in it. There was no presence in it at all. It was just something learned that we went through. It was like a military drill. But I tell you, friends, we also need not only the spirit in worship, but we also need the truth. Because without truth, we become like clanging cymbals. It's more like mayhem. It's really not a heart that's seeking the Lord. We need to worship in spirit and in truth. When the apostolic prophetic church puts the cross before us and not behind us, we're going to be able to keep a perfect balance. Praise God. I was sharing the story of Nick Walenda. Anybody know who Nick Walenda is? Remember that guy? He was the guy that stretched a high wire across Niagara Falls and walked across that thing. He's a high wire. The Walendas, I think their family was called, what was it, the Flying Walendas? They must have been eagles. Eh? But the Flying Walendas, and here this guy is. And what I loved about this report, now, ABC News wouldn't report it. All they showed was him walking across. They didn't show the part about him praying his way across and praying in the spirit and praying with his understanding and kneeling down and giving glory to God right in the middle of it. You know what? If I was in the middle of the Niagara Gorge, this is why I don't do that, okay? Now, I've got the same spirit as Nick Walenda, but I do not have the same truth. Because the truth is, he knows what he's doing. I don't know how to do that, all right? But I noticed the picture of Nick, you know, all these high wire people, they got this big bar that helps them keep balance. Just like the crossbar of the cross, right there, keeps us in balance, praise God. That's so important, I believe, in this day, when people are skewing off in one direction or another, praise God. Listen, the cross is the wisdom and the power of God. We need them both. It's not an either or. It's so important. It's why the cross is also a perfect balance of grace and truth. Amen? Because without grace, we can't handle the truth. But without truth, we will surely mishandle grace. We've got to come to that place in this day. I believe that's why this ministry is so important, that we walk in that perfect balance of the cross of Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. I also want to praise the Lord for the face of the eagle here at Eagle Worldwide Ministries. You know, what I love about Russ and Maeve is they don't keep the prophetic bottled up. It's not just them. But when you're willing to be discipled and you're willing to submit to authority, like to come up here and to share with Pastor Patty or whomever's in charge at a given time what the Lord's put in your heart, they give you the liberty to exercise that gift, praise God. That is so important. You don't find that everywhere. Most places that we go, all the action's on the platform. There's no action going on anywhere else. Nobody else is getting an opportunity. You know, that was a great thing about beginning to move in the Holy Spirit. Suddenly, you know, they started talking, we have gifts? We're called? I thought that was just the guy with the robe. But we've got a call. We've got a destiny. God could use us. You mean we could do something other than cut the grass and clean the toilet? Seriously? We could actually lay hands on people and pray for them? I remember when our pastor put us in a prayer group and told us to lead it, and we was looking at him like, You know, this is the blind leading the blind here, you know, because we didn't. But he gave us some liberty. He gave us some teaching, too. That's why all of this is so important. And I love the fact that they teach on the prophetic and they impart the anointing of the prophetic and they give the opportunity to exercise these gifts. Many places we go talk a good eagle, but they tie everyone to the nest. They don't let them loose to fly. Remember the revelation? What did it say? It was a flying eagle, not a perched one, praise God. But I want to come tonight to spend a little time here talking about the face of an ox. I've hardly ever heard anything about the face of the ox, except in passing, and then people want to jump to the more exciting ones, the Lion of Judah, or the eagle, or whatever else, the Son of Man, and all the rest. We're more familiar with God revealing himself through these particular living creatures and ministries as the Son of Man, the Lion of Judah, and the Flying Eagle, but rarely do we see anybody who has an understanding of the revelation of the ox. But if we want the full revelation of God, we can't leave out the face of the ox, praise God. Now, what does the ox reveal to us? Remember, these creatures were where? In the presence of God. They were just constantly worshiping and adoring and exalting God Almighty. They're in the presence of God, so they're an expression of God himself. But what does the ox speak up to us about? Well, the ox has great strength. The ox is about serving. The ox is about productivity. Because when you've got an ox hooked up to a plow, you can increase your productivity. It's a powerful, powerful concept, a powerful animal. And it also speaks, the ox speaks to the increase of wealth. You know, in ancient Israel, a family's ox was their livelihood. You ever notice how many times an ox is spoken of in the Old Testament? There are all kinds of admonitions about oxen, if you're talking about a yoke, two of them together. All kinds of admonitions about that. Don't covet your neighbor's ox. Don't steal your neighbor's ox. Don't kill your neighbor's ox. And even if you see your neighbor's ox running loose, it's your responsibility to make sure he gets back to the person that owns him. This was their livelihood. Without this, they would starve. That they wouldn't be able to function. It was the most expensive and it was the most desired animal that they could have. In fact, if you were found guilty of stealing or killing someone's ox, the Old Testament law required a fivefold return. Five for one. That's how seriously they took this particular animal. So the ox was the most valuable animal on the farm and critical for the welfare of all. You know the scriptures, Proverbs 14:14. Where no oxen are, what? The stable, the trough is very clean. It's a great picture, isn't it? But much increase comes by the strength of an ox. I think most of us realize that if two oxen are yoked together, they are better and stronger and more productive than one who is laboring alone. That's based on Ecclesiastes 4:9. Two are better than one alone because they have a good reward for their labor. Heard this example. You know the Clydesdale horses? You know, they're not racehorses. They're these huge draft animals. They kind of function in much the same way an ox would, okay? The big Clydesdale horses. One Clydesdale can pull a sled that weighs 2 tons. But you yoke 2 Clydesdales together, and they can pull a sled of 8 tons. What an exponential increase. I believe that this is speaking directly to us about how productive we are going to be in our lives. Not only in our personal lives, in our marriage and in our family, but in the life of the ministry with whom we're yoked. Favor, the force of favor is powerful when you're yoked with the right people. That's why Valerie and I were blessed of God that the first ministry in the east of Canada that opened the door to us was this ministry. There is a force of favor associated with that, praise God. And that's what you are here to tap into, to the glory of God. Oxen were essential to plowing the fields and also to prepare them for sowing. But they were also useful in the harvest. I think we can all see a picture of an oxen, you know, or a yoke of oxen pulling a plow or moving trees or stumps or huge boulders and so forth. But they were also important to the harvest. And you're familiar again with some of these scriptures. Deuteronomy 25:4, you shall not muzzle an ox while it treads out the grain. That's quoted again by the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 9, where it says, for it is written in the law of Moses, you shall not muzzle an ox while it treads out the grain. Is it oxen that God is concerned about? Or does he say it altogether for our sakes? I'm not here to try to persuade you to go out and buy an oxen, okay? We don't really use oxen anymore. Not many of us would even have a use for a Clydesdale. Maybe a good tractor, okay? Or a nice car, whatever else, but something else that could be that productive for us. See, this is really a spiritual principle that speaks to us. It's for our sakes, no doubt, that this is written, that he who plows and should plow in hope, and he who threshes in hope should be a partaker of his hope. If we have sown spiritual things for you, is it too great a thing if we reap your material things? That's a spiritual principle. I think most of us are familiar with that. A great strength in this ministry is all the oxen, spiritually speaking, who are employed in the work of ministry. Now, that's not only a mark of a good ministry, it's the mark of a great leader. Because a great leader will always be employing many spiritual oxen. When we were pastoring for 30 years, I know that when I would look to, you know, adding someone to our staff, one of the first things that would come to my mind was not whether they were a nice person or, you know, how godly they were or how gifted they were or whatever. I'll tell you what my first thought was. Are they going to bring increase? I mean, what's the use of an oxen? You know how much an oxen would eat? How much a Clydesdale would eat? I've seen people with dogs that I don't know how they feed them. I mean, you know, you could throw a saddle on some of these dogs. How much do they eat? And I can tell you what, the trough is not clean where you keep one of those dogs. But I regress. But it's so very important that we take this into consideration. What we're doing is we're serving. We're to bring productivity. We're to bring increase, praise God. That's what it's all about. The more of us that can be yoked together, the more increase we're going to see. The stronger the church and the work of ministry is going to be. That's why this is important. I look at the Grassics and I think, wow, there's a great yoke of oxen right there. I mean, you know, they're equally yoked. And you know what my picture of the yoke is? The cross. I mean, we don't have one here, do we? But anyway, if you took that cross and you grabbed the crossbar and walked together, you would be yoked, wouldn't you? Yeah, that's the yoke that I believe Jesus said. Listen, Jesus paid it all on the cross. Don't be afraid of the yoke. Jesus has done all the heavy lifting. okay? But there's still some for us to do, okay? And that's why we need to be equally. I look at Mark and Jeanette. You're a great yoke of oxen, praise God. I'm not calling you a cow, okay? I'm not saying that because you're a great barbecue guy. No, it's a spiritual identity, praise the Lord. There's a time to be the eagle, to see and to speak, to prophesy and declare. There's a time to be to be the Lion of Judah, to roar and to worship in spirit and in truth, praise God. But there's also a time to serve. There's a time to be productive. There's a time to be a part of the increase. Amen? That's why I appreciate. You're not married, are you? But you're an ox in the house. Amen? Because you serve. You don't have to be married to be an ox, okay? Or to be even yoked with others. Because I've seen people in the offices here at Eagle Worldwide. They're single or, you know, they're married, but maybe their husbands are not involved in the ministry. And yet they're yoked with people for the work of ministry. That isn't ministry. What's that word? It's serving, isn't it? Isn't that what it's about? It's about serving, praise God. This is not only honorable, but this speaks of the presence of God. You know, I find that a lot of people in the our world today, our full gospel, spirit-filled, whatever we are today, I find that a lot of people are just in it for the fun. I just want to run and clap and dance and skip and have a great time, but don't ask me to do anything. You know, don't try to yoke me to anything. Oh, no, I didn't come here to work. Well, go somewhere else then. Because you're not going to bring any increase. See, that's what this is really about. It's understanding. What did Jesus say about his yoke? My yoke is easy and the load, the burden is light. Amen? This is a joy to be a part of something that's bigger than ourselves. I'm not even sure if I would be alive but for the grace of God bringing this woman into my life. Because let me tell you what, we are yoked. She said divorce is not an option. She takes a good Catholic stance on that. There is no divorce. Murder's a possibility, but divorce is just not in the picture. Now, we're very different. We are very, very different. But I tell you what, we've learned that those differences are actually how God strengthens us. Because where I'm weak, she's strong. Where she's weak, I'm strong. We can do more together than we could do alone, praise God. That's why the enemy is so viciously attacking marriage and family today. That's why we're confronted with all this gender confusion. And I mean, you know, the 60s were wild and crazy. But if you'd ever told me that the winner of the decathlon and the Olympics was going to turn into a whatever that is, I don't know. I can't quite make it out yet. I'm like, say what? You know, and now all the news media are declaring, what a hero. He's made their hero list. I'm like, a hero? I don't even know if he's a shero. I mean, what? I'll get in trouble now. You know what it is? We live in a narcissistic generation. Everybody just wants to do their own thing. They want to do what they please. They want to cast off all restraints. They do not want the burden of responsibility or accountability. Nothing. They don't want to be held accountable for whether they bring any increase into life and ministry or not. And that's a shame. That's got to change. That's why these things I'm talking about. Now, I'm talking about this ministry that we're intimately involved with and fully support. And I'm not necessarily trying to recruit you to this ministry. I'm just saying, I know many of you are from other ministries and so forth. But these are things that we ought to be looking at. I mean, if the leader is the only ox in the field, that ought to tell you something. Because great leaders have more than one oxen in the game. They're always looking for others that can yoke together and work together and it all be for the glory of God. Let me give you a quick example of a man in the Old Testament who I believe was a great, great leader. And God thought so too. Elisha. Remember Elisha? He was such a man who had employed many oxen. You remember the story, don't you, that when Elijah was running from that woman, Jezebel, she's still alive and well, by the way, but when Elijah was running from Jezebel, he ends up hiding in a cave, and God calls him out of the cave. What are you doing here? You remember all that? You went through. Let me read a little bit of that to you, just to kind of refresh your memory there. He comes out of the cave, and what did he say? He said, "I'm all alone. I'm all alone." That's not a great leader. A great leader is never all alone. Amen. A great leader is always going to have other oxen. So he said, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the children of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, killed your prophets with the sword, and I alone am left, and they seek to take my life." And then the Lord said to him, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when you arrive, anoint Hazael as king over Syria. Also, you shall anoint Jehu, the son of Nimshi, as king over Israel, and Elisha," remember him, "Elisha, the son of Shaphat, you shall anoint as prophet in your place. It shall be that whoever escapes the sword of one will be killed by the other. Yet I have reserved 7,000 in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him." So Elijah departed from there, and he found Elisha. And guess what he found Elisha doing? He was out in the field. He was in his natural father's field. But he's not out there with just one yoke of oxen. How many yokes he got out there? He's got 12 yokes of oxen out there. I would say that God had a good eye for who needed to be the next prophet in the land, wouldn't you? He also had an answer for Elijah's complaint that he felt like he was all alone. He said, "Well, I'm going to yoke you up with somebody for a season. And when you are caught up into heaven, you're going to release your mantle to him, and he's going to carry on." See, that's the mark of a good leader, praise God. The serving part is not the drudgery part. I believe it's actually the part that qualifies us for the really great things of the Lord. Amen? It shows that we're willing to serve, praise God. I mean, what did Jesus say about himself? He came to serve, didn't he? He came to serve the Son of Man in the midst of us. How could that be a bad thing? Now, in my own understanding, I believe that when Elijah was caught up into heaven, remember, right before that, what did Elisha ask for? Why do you want a double portion? I mean, was he just greedy? Was he egotistical, ambitious? What was that about? I believe it was because when he was yoked with Elijah, he knew how strong they were together. But now his spiritual father's being taken from him, and he realizes, I need a double anointing. I need more than what I normally operate in, praise God. That's important, friends. It was the same thing that was going on with King Saul. You remember how Samuel anointed King Saul? He anointed him king with a flask. I guess it'd be sort of like a bottle of oil. But when the day came that he was to anoint David as the next king over Israel, he didn't use a flask or a bottle or a jar. What did he use? A horn. What's a horn? Yeah, but what does it represent? Authority, power, strength, all of those things. An anointing, praise God. Listen, friends, in troubled times like this present evil age, we need another anointing. Let me close with this. If you got your Bible there or your phone or whatever you're using, Turn with me to Psalm 92. Psalm 92 describes a day like today. Verse 7 says, when the wicked spring up like grass, and when all the workers of iniquity flourish, it is that they may be destroyed forever. You know, right now, it just seems like we're being hit with an avalanche of immorality and antichrist spirit. And it's like every week you wonder, wow, what's next? You know, right after the gay marriage thing went through in the United States, the next week we heard a California congresswoman arguing that we needed to do away in marriage ceremonies with the term husband and wife. Because now, if we're going to disestablish marriage and disconnect it and cut it off from the revelation of God's word, if you got a group that want to be married or whatever you got going on, then fine. That's what the kind of evil age we're living in. Every time you turn around, there's another tragic shooting. Mostly in the States, but my goodness, we've had our share of it here in Canada, haven't we? I mean, how many of you have ever walked past that war memorial there in the nation's capital and seen that honor guard? Did you know the honor guard that stands there doesn't even have a bullet? It's a ceremonial gun. Okay, that's all it is. It's a ceremonial post to honor the dead of the nation who gave their lives in battle. Gets shot in the back right there as he's standing in on honor guard duty. Or what about the three RCMP officers in Moncton? Gunned down in the street. For what? Why? What was that all about? Every time we talk, what about this tragedy down there in South Carolina when this crazy demon-possessed guy goes into a church, sits in on their Bible study? Okay, he's invited. He definitely was a little different. It was a black church. He was a white guy. Okay, I imagine they were a little surprised, but you know what? They were open to him. They invited him to be a part of the group and all the rest. He sits there for an hour and stands up and starts blowing them away. We don't need a blow away. We need a blowout. We need a blowout. We need it in the first in the church, and then we need it in the land, praise God. Because it looks like the wicked are springing up like grass. And it looks like they're getting away with it and they're flourishing. You ever feel that way? Why do the wicked prosper? You know, why are the rest of us having a harder time? But you, Lord, are on high forever, and behold your enemies, O Lord, for behold your enemies shall perish, and the workers of iniquity shall be scattered. Here's where we're coming to right now. Oh, praise God. But my horn you have exalted like a wild ox. My horn you have exalted like a wild ox. I have been anointed with fresh oil. My eye has also seen my desire on my enemies. What's your desire on your enemies? Think before you answer. What if we have God's heart, what should be our desire on our enemies? Because you know what? They would think the worst possible thing would be that they would be as crazy as we are. That they would repent and get saved and filled with the Holy Ghost and turn into a God fanatic. Many of them would think that would be worse than death. They really would. So that would be a good desire, I would think, to have on your enemies, praise God. That may come under the category of heaping coals on their head. But anyway, so yeah, my desire on the wicked, my ears hear my desire on the wicked who rise up against me. Oh, listen to this. The righteous shall flourish like a palm tree. I like that. Palm trees grow in warm places. Yeah, like the Mediterranean or somewhere, you know. Yeah, I like that. Praise God. He shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. Those who are planted in the house of the Lord. How many of you are planted in the house of the Lord? Amen. Not a tumbleweed blowing through. Those who are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall bear fruit in old age. Do I get an amen? Come on now. I'm probably one of the oldest ones here. They shall bear fruit in old age. I claim that one in Jesus' name. Praise God. They shall bear fruit in old age. They shall be fresh and flourishing. Don't you like? This is the force of favor, folks. Bearing fruit, being fresh, being flourishing. To declare that the Lord is upright, He is my God, and there is no unrighteousness in Him. Praise the Lord. Oh, bless God. Folks, we need in the church, we need a wild ox anointing to scatter the enemy so that we can flourish. We need an anointing so that we can grow, so that we can bear fresh fruit in old age, to declare that the Lord is upright and He is my rock. That all sounds like the force of favor to me, doesn't it, to you? I mean, when you're flourishing, when you're being fruitful, even in old age, praise God. I know some of you young people think, you know, the old crowd, what fun do they have? Valerie and I can tell you after 47 years of marriage, we're having the best time of our lives. And not just in marriage, in ministry, with family. I mean, the favor of God. It's an awesome, awesome force. We need to receive it. This wild ox anointing, if you will. I mean, otherwise, what are we going to do? We can't always just play safe or try to conform to somebody else's anointing. There are times when God wants us to move without restriction, like the wild oxen under this horn anointing that He has for our lives. When it's time to do battle, a yoke of oxen could bring provision and equipment to an army, but are you going to throw a saddle on one and ride it into battle? I mean, that's not going to be of much value. No, you know, see, I believe in everyone who is a servant in the house of the Lord, who serves in the courts of our God. I believe in every one of us, there's a little of this wild ox. This wild ox anointing for the day of battle, when the wicked are springing up like grass, when restraints are being thrown off, when we're wondering what's going to happen, bad things going to happen from one week to the next, praise God. When it's time to do battle, that's when we need this wild ox anointing. When generals like Dr. Russ Moyer blow the horn, that tells us right there, all right, it's time to shift from what we've been doing, praise God, to this anointing of the wild ox. Deuteronomy 33:17, last verse. God's glory is like a bull, and His horns are like the horns of the wild ox, praise God. You know, I could go on and on with people that Val and I so admire for their service in this ministry, in other ministries that we're a part of, and it just shows us that we're yoked to the right crowd, praise God. Who wants to receive a little of that wild ox anointing? Come on, stand up. Stand up. If you want to receive some of this wild, this is the anointing of God. This is His doing here. This is the glory of God. In fact, we've got a horn of oil. We're privileged to stay with Russ and Mae from time to time. And I'd seen this in their house. And I said, where's that horn of oil? We want that tonight, praise God. So if you want that anointing, that wild ox anointing, I don't want you to ever think, oh, poor old ox anymore. Just kind of plodding along, grinding it out, how boring and all that. I don't want you to have that picture in your mind anymore. I want you to think about an ox, a wild ox anointing that scatters the enemy, praise God, that brings a force of favor into our lives so that we flourish, so that we bear fruit, even in old age, praise God. Listen, friends, I am fully convinced for all of us in this tent, our best days are ahead of us in Jesus' name. Amen? Praise God. We're going to anoint you tonight. Give me some of that oil, sweetheart. Cool with it. Praise God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. There it comes. There it comes. Thank you, Lord God. Father, I just thank you right now. I thank you for this wild ox anointing. Praise God. Thank you, Lord God. I thank you for strength. I thank you for service. I thank you, Lord God, for those who are rightly yoked together. But I also thank you for that wild ox anointing that scatters the enemy, praise God, that brings our desire down upon them in Jesus' awesome name. Thank you, Lord, for this wild ox anointing. Oh, thank you. Yes, free. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for this wild ox anointing. I heard you say to me tonight, you're retired and it's good. But that's not the end for us. It's not to fade away. It's not to sit on the porch in a rocking chair and watch life go by. You've got a wild ox anointing upon you now. That's going to stir you to some things that you missed out on in the past, some new things that you had not even thought of, praise God. You're going to find a new energy and a new desire. I want to be a part of what God is doing in His house and in the courts of the Lord.